तत्सवितुर्वरं रूपं ज्योतिः परस्य धीमहि यन्नः सत्येन दीपये। ॐ शांति शांति शांतिः। नमस्कार माय डियर ब्रदर्स एंड सिस्टर्स, ऑन दिस ऑस्पिशियस ओकेजन ऑफ द इंटरनेशनल डे ऑफ योगा, इट्स माय ऑनर एंड प्रिविलेज टू सेंड यू फ्रॉम श्री अरबिंदो आश्रम दिल्ली ब्रांच द लव एंड ब्लेसिंग्स ऑफ द मदर एंड श्री अरबिंदो। दिस टॉक इज ऑन योगा एंड द योगा दैट वी शैल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट इज Integral Yoga, the yoga of Sri Aurobindo and the mother. Sri Aurobindo worked out about 100 years ago a very powerful synthesis of all the major traditional schools of yoga, and that is what is popularly called the Integral Yoga. And the mother put it into practice in Sri Aurobindo Ashram at Pondicherry and demonstrated that it's not all theory, it can be actually put into practice. The title of the talk is rather enigmatic, Yoga Visible and Invisible. Now first the visible part. The visible part of yoga are the asanas, pranayama and meditation, the techniques with which yoga is commonly identified. Why these techniques cannot be the whole of yoga is very easy to understand. After all, what do these techniques do? They improve the function of the body and the mind. And what are the body and the mind? The body and the mind are our instruments. These are the instruments that we use for everything that we do, be it professional work, household work. In all the work that we do, we use a combination of the body and the mind. And if the instruments are working better, then the quality of whatever we do improves. And therefore, a person who has improved the function of the body and the mind by using these yogic techniques will be able to do a better job as a teacher or a doctor, an engineer, a scientist, a manager, a farmer, a carpenter, or as a homemaker. And that's of course nice, that's very desirable. But then just ponder over a simple question. Suppose a terrorist is physically unfit, emotionally unstable, and intellectually dull. Will he be able to launch a successful terrorist attack? No, he won't be able to. And therefore, if this terrorist also improves the function of his body and mind by using the yogic techniques, he improves his chances of becoming a more successful terrorist. Now, if a discipline helps a teacher as much as it helps a terrorist, that discipline cannot qualify as spiritual, and we all know that yoga is a spiritual discipline. What makes yoga a spiritual discipline is the fact that the yoga not only has the techniques for improving the function of the body and the mind, yoga also provides guidance on how to use the body and the mind. One might almost put it mathematically, yoga is equal to its techniques plus its guidance for life. Now, what is the type of guidance that yoga provides us for living? At the cost of oversimplification, one might reduce this guidance to three basic components. The first is about the way we do our work. The work that we do remains the same. It is the attitude that changes, because the ability to do the work, the opportunity to do the work, have all been given to us by God, and we are His instruments. And in fact, it's our privilege to be chosen as instruments, because after all, the Divine has no shortage of instruments. It's not in a hurry to accomplish something. And since we are not the doers, but only instruments of God, we should not insist on a particular outcome, because the outcome has been determined by the one whose instruments we are. For example, in the Gita, Lord Krishna tells Arjun that for all practical purposes, the Kauravas are already dead. Mayaivaite nirtaha purvameva. Because that decision I have taken. So for all practical purposes, they are dead. But you be the channel, nimatamatram bhava savyasachin, you be the channel, the instrument to do it. And why has he been chosen as the instrument? Because he is dear to God. And therefore, Lord Krishna wants that he should win the glory of having won the war, yasholabhasva. And therefore, to be chosen as an instrument for doing something is a privilege. And therefore, one should do the work to the best of one's ability, but at the same time not insist on a particular outcome. For example, the outcome in this case was that the Kauravas will die, and over that Arjun had no control. Arjun was not entitled to determine what should be the outcome of the war. And sometimes, you know, this is interpreted as saying that if what has to happen will happen anyway, then I can do the job in a perfunctory manner. Jo hona hai, wo to hona hi hai. To khana puri mujhe bhi karni hai, main kaam kisi bhi tarah se kar lu. But that is not true, because we have to look at the whole thing instead of just concentrating on the one fact that the outcome is not determined by us. It's a privilege to have been chosen as the instrument, and therefore we should put our heart and soul into the work. Another way to put it is that since all this has been given to us, the ability to do the work and the opportunity to do the work should be offered to the one who has given it to us. And if it has to be offered to the divine, it should be fit to be offered. And to be fit to be offered, it should be done in the best way we can. The second component is about what to do, which work to do. Because within the course of the work that we do, we have choices to make. And even otherwise, in the course of everyday life, there are so many choices to be made, small and big. For example, Arjun's choice was to fight or not to fight. We also have to make choices. And how do we make those choices? To understand the process of choice making, let's take an example. Suppose there's a building on fire. There's a fireman in front of it. And he's told that probably there are a few people trapped inside the building. He quickly gets an impulse. Let me enter the building and try to rescue them. But then before he actually does it, he gets another thought. It will be very hot and suffocating inside. And it will also be very risky. Suppose I die, what will happen to my family? Now we can see that there are three types of voices that he is hearing. One is that will be very hot and suffocating inside. This is the voice of the emotional part of the being, which looks for pleasant experiences and tries to avoid unpleasant ones. The second voice, it will be very risky. I might die. What will happen to my family? That's the voice of the intellect, which works on the basis of reason and tries to make a choice based on what is most profitable and least risky. So what we find is that the emotional part of the being is telling him not to enter the building, and the intellect has found reasons to support what he feels like doing, or rather not doing. But what about that initial impulse that he got? Let me enter the building. That came from his divine essence, the soul. The soul is not there just to give us the consolation that at least some part of us will continue to live even after we are dead and gone. The soul also has a dynamic aspect that whispers to us in a shy and faint but very clear voice and very quickly what the right thing to do is. This aspect of the soul, or our divine essence, which is the spokesperson of the soul, tells us in no uncertain terms, very quickly and clearly, what the right thing to do is. And it is this aspect of the soul that has been called by Sri Aurobindo and the mother, the psychic being. So it is the voice of a psychic being that told him to enter the burning building. But then the voice of the psychic being is not only faint, it is also a voice that does not insist. On the other hand, the emotional part of the being and the intellect can be very noisy and very persistent, and the result is that very often this little voice gets drowned. Now let us see what would be the consequences of listening to, paying heed to, or not paying heed to the voice of the psychic being. Suppose this person decides to enter the building. The experience is hot and suffocating. He may or may not succeed in rescuing anybody, but irrespective of the outcome, how does he feel when he comes out? He is happy. And it's a type of happiness which is unique, a little higher than the usual idea of happiness that we have, and therefore we call it joy. He experiences joy. And what is even more important is that now he gets lasting mental peace. He knows that I did my best, and therefore he is at peace. Now what are the consequences of not listening to this voice? Suppose later on it's discovered that a few people died inside the building. He feels guilty and he feels very uneasy, and this uneasiness can become recurrent. It can bother him for days together, and it can keep coming up again and again, off and on, maybe throughout his life. So that is the contrast. The reward of listening to this voice is lasting mental peace, whereas the punishment for not listening to it is recurrent uneasiness. So the psychic being is not only a guide, it is also an inbuilt reward and punishment system. Very often the question is raised, but how do we identify the voice of the psychic being? How do we know it is the voice of the psychic being, and so on? The mother says, in fact, identifying the voice of the psychic being is not difficult. It's very easy. It's only because we don't feel like listening to it that we start making excuses. But still, if there are doubts about whether or not a particular choice is coming from our soul or the psychic being, then all we have to do is to ask ourselves one simple question and answer it in total honesty, with total sincerity. The question is, will this choice leave me in lasting mental peace? We might have 100 justifications for another choice, but still we know that sooner or later an uneasy feeling will catch up with us, because that is not actually the right thing to do, although we can justify it. And the reason is a very versatile tool. It can justify just about anything. And therefore, we can find several reasons even for doing what should not be done or for not doing what should be done. But the only choice that leaves us in lasting mental peace is the choice that comes from the psychic being. So that is the second aspect of the guidance that yoga gives, what to do. So apart from what to do and how to do it, what else does yoga guide us about? It's commonly assumed that if a person always does the right thing in the right way, then he'll have no problems in life. This is a misunderstanding of spirituality. Just because a person is doing everything right in the right way, it does not make the person immune to a road accident or to a failed marriage or an incurable illness or a huge financial loss. All these problems can still visit him. But what yoga does is to tell us how to face these problems, how to respond to these problems. Yoga looks upon whatever happens to us in life as something that comes with a meaning, comes with a message, and it is an opportunity for spiritual growth, which is the very purpose of human existence. We can grow spiritually both through misfortune and good fortune, but the sad fact is most of us grow more through misfortune than through good fortune, and that is why these blows fall on us. Now first let's see how we can grow through good fortune. Good fortune means we have excess of something, and how do we get that excess? Because it is given to us. So we should accept this good fortune with a sense of gratitude. And how do we express this gratitude? By sharing what we have in excess with those who need it. And we are not really helping those with whom we share it, we are helping ourselves, because that is the way we grow spiritually, fulfill the purpose of our life through good fortune. How about misfortune? When we face a situation in which we find ourselves totally helpless, all the resources that we were proud of prove completely useless, then we turn to a higher power. And we also realize our interrelatedness, because in that type of situation, many instruments of the divine materialize and they come and help us in that situation. So we realize our interrelatedness. We develop a sense of love and oneness with others, and that is how we grow spiritually through misfortune. Now this gives us a dispassionate way of looking good fortune and misfortune. They are given to us because we need them. We need them because they are necessary for fulfilling the purpose of life, and therefore both should be faced with equal delight. That is the guidance that yoga gives. That is the samatva of the Gita. Samatvam yoga uchyate. Now what happens as a result of doing in the right way, the right thing to be done, and responding to these ups and downs of life with a yogic attitude? What happens as a result of this is that very often we do make mistakes, and when we make mistakes and when we do not make mistakes, all that leads to an inner experience, and that leads to an inner churning. If we have made a mistake, then we realize that somewhere deep within we knew what the right thing to do was, but still we didn't do it. And then we resolve that in future, on a similar occasion, I will do it differently. Now all this inner work that is going on eventually leads to a transformation of the emotional part of the being and the intellect. After all, what is the emotional part of the being looking for? It is looking for happiness, it is looking for a pleasant experience, and it realizes that there's a superior version of happiness which we call joy, and even more important, lasting mental peace, which also the emotional part of the being wants, comes from a certain category of choices. And in contrast, other choices give us an uneasiness, restlessness, agitation. Then it starts choosing, because of these experiences, on its own, the type of choices that lead to lasting mental peace. And these choices invariably are the choices that arise out of a sense of love and oneness. And if the psychic being gives us that type of choices and the emotional part of the being also makes the same choices, then there's no discrepancy left between the two as a result of this transformation of the emotional part of the being. And if the psychic being and the emotional part of the being are united, if they are speaking in the same language, then the intellect quickly falls in line, because it's a very versatile tool and it quickly invents reasons to support that choice. So the result is that there's a unification of the three tools that we use for making choices: the emotional part of the being, the intellect, and the soul or the psychic being. And how about the body? The body is a docile instrument. It does what the mind tells it to do. And thus, there is a unification of the body, the emotional part of the being, the intellect, and the soul. The emotional part of the being and the intellect together are the mind. And this is what is commonly known as the union of the body, mind, and spirit. The spirit is more or less the same as the soul. And this union is not a one-time event, it's a process. It's a process of gradual transformation of the emotional part of the being and the intellect, so that habitually we start working more and more in light of our divine essence or the psychic being. And it is this union which is the goal of yoga. So yoga is both a process of taking us towards that goal, and it is also the goal itself, the goal of total unification. Total unification of all parts of the being, so that we are constantly aware of the voice of our psychic being, and habitually all parts of the being speak in the same language as the soul, is a remote goal for most of us. Probably we will not reach it in this lifetime. But what is important is that every step that we take in the right direction towards this union gives us more and more of everything that we are looking for: joy, lasting mental peace, avoiding a sense of guilt and recurrent uneasiness, good health, and a sense of fulfillment. And thus, the journey of yoga becomes an enjoyable journey. It becomes so enjoyable that one can, in fact, forget about the destination and leave it to the divine. Forgetting about the destination and leaving it to the divine is the best way to actually get to it. Because if we remain obsessed with the goal, it only outdistances us. Before we conclude, you might ask, where do the asanas, pranayama, and meditation fit into this entire scheme? They fit very well, because whatever we do and whichever way we do it, we still need the combination of the body and the mind. And if the instruments have been improved by using these techniques, we'll be able to live a yogic life better. We'll live a healthier life, so that we'll have more time available. So living a yogic life or a spiritual life also needs the same instruments, the body and the mind. And therefore, improving the function of these by using the yogic techniques helps us live a yogic life better. So these techniques are the visible part, whereas the attitude that we have towards our work, the way we decide what to do, and how we face the ups and downs of life is the invisible part of yoga. Because when a person is doing asanas or pranayamas or meditation, anybody can see it. But the rest of it, when the person is trying to follow the guidance provided by yoga for living a life, not much is visible, except that people around may sometimes start feeling that now this person does the job much better, or he has become much more loving and compassionate. But much of what is going on within, the person himself only knows. And therefore, that is the invisible part of yoga. And it is this invisible part of yoga that defines integral yoga, that sets it apart from the popular conception of yoga. So integral yoga is not about a unique way of doing the asanas and pranayamas. It is not about a patented technique of meditation. It is the invisible part of yoga that defines it. And that is what makes it also a 24-hour yoga. We sometimes asked, how long does this particular yoga take? Now, when a person asks such a question, the person is thinking of only the visible part of yoga. It may take an hour or two in a day, but when one starts following the guidance provided by yoga, the invisible part of yoga, that goes on for all 24 hours, and it is a lifetime commitment. Because after all, if we do our work in a certain way, make choices in a certain way, because after all, the way we do what we do and the way we respond to the ups and downs of life constitutes life. What else is there left in life? क्या करें, कैसे करें और सुख दुख का सामना कैसे करें, ये सब कुछ अगर योग के अनुसार कर लिया तो बाकी जीवन में बचा ही क्या. एंड दैट इज हाउ वी कैन ईजिली अंडरस्टैंड वन ऑफ द सेलिब्रेटेड कोर्स ऑफ श्री अरविंदो, ऑल लाइफ इज योगा, विच मीन्स दैट ऑल लाइफ इज अ फील्ड फॉर द प्रैक्टिस ऑफ योगा. ऑल लाइफ गिव्स अस अपॉर्चुनिटीज थ्रू आउट इन एवरीथिंग दैट हैपन्स टू अस. Everything that we do for the practice of yoga. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnam Eva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.